Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's get started with the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper, beginning with a very sad news from Amritsar. More than 60 people who were celebrating Dasera were killed after a train ran over hundreds who were watching the Dasera proceedings. The tracks at Amritsar were on a higher ground, which gave a better view of the burning effigy of Ravan. As this effigy of Ravan was lit, the fireworks went off. A section of crowd, they then retreated towards the tracks where a large number of people were already standing to watch the celebrations. And then the people were hit because they could not see or hear the train due to the exploding crackers. And more than 60 innocent lives were lost. Thinking about this horrific tragedy, we need to ask few questions. Who organized the Dasera festival so close to the train track? Did the authorities permit it? Who left the rail crossing open? And why should we celebrate with so many firecrackers very close to a train track? Because it has the potential to cause a mishap. So these are the questions we are juggling and struggling to find an answer to. Let's hope the authorities, both at the central government level and at the state level, will answer these questions and come up with authoritative statements on the issue. But what we need to also look at the very larger issue of crowd management. We are still failing in our techniques to manage a crowd, be it at a festival, be it at a concert, be it at an event. And ultimately, because of inefficiency in the manner in which we control the crowd, ultimately we are losing a lot many innocent lives day in and day out. So what we need to understand from the mains point of view, that we need to have an efficient crowd management policy in place. And for that, National Disaster Management Authority has already released a set of rules, but we have not been following these rules. That's the unfortunate, sad side of the story. But these rules have been released by National Disaster Management Authority. So if you look at this video, just under the description, you will find a link to our CNA. Please take a look at that CNA and you will find all these rules mentioned by National Disaster Management Authority related to the crowd management. Let's look at another issue. Agricultural laborers, farmers, they spray pesticides on their crops and fields. And these pesticides are also toxic. And they have the potential to affect the life and security of these agricultural farmers. Now, what has happened? If you look at these pesticides, majority of these pesticides are organophosphate based. And these are toxic and they affect the nervous system. They affect the heart as well. There are esters present in these organophosphate. These esters can enter into the body. How they enter into the body? Normally through the skin. Although they can enter into the body through inhalation as well. But majority of the times they enter the body through the skin. When they enter the body through the skin, they have the potential to inhibit an enzyme called acetylcholinesterase or ACHE. They inhibit this enzyme. That means they have the potential of one way or the other destroying this enzyme so that this enzyme does not work effectively. And what is the important purpose of this enzyme? It is very important for our nervous system. It is very important for our muscle function as well. And when these esters, which are present in these organophosphate based pesticides, when they enter into the body through the skin and then they inhibit this enzyme, it causes neurological disorders, suffocation, paralysis, and sometimes death as well. Now we have a solution. And that is why this topic is relevant for your GS paper 3 and has a potential of being asked in your prelims examination. And what is the solution? What is the innovation that has been called for? A gel has been developed by researchers. This gel, when it is applied on the skin, it has the potential to inhibit these pesticides from getting absorbed by the body. That means since these pesticides were getting absorbed into the body through the skin, if you apply this gel on the skin, then this pesticide will not be absorbed by the skin. And that is the most important benefit of this gel and has the potential of being asked in your examination. And one important detail, these tests were successfully conducted on rats. Now human trials will start soon, and once the human trials are over, then we will see the mass production of these gels, which can be of huge benefit for our farmers and industrial workers, agricultural workers. Now let's look at another issue. Three national political parties have failed to submit donation list. Now let's understand this newspaper article in great detail. Money is needed for political parties, or funds are needed by political parties. Why do political parties need funds, need money? Because to propagate their ideology, they need money. To organize rallies, they need money. To pay their workers, they need money. For various activities belonging to these political parties, wherein they create awareness in the society, they do require money. So there can be no two opinions on this, that political parties in India need funds, need money. But these funds should be clean. These funds should not be illicit. This money should not be black money. But how do these political parties generate funds, generate money for their activities? Through public. You and me, we agree with the ideology of a political party, we can donate money to this political party. Second, through fees as well. For example, if you want to join a political party, you have to pay a membership fee to that political party. And it is through that membership fee that political parties also raise their funds. But majority of the money that is given to these political parties, the major donors are these corporates. And corporates are the biggest donors to the political parties. That is why we say in India, it is the corporates which decide which political party will form the government in the center and at the states. But how do these political parties acquire this money? There was a time 2 years ago, when if you are donating money to a political party in excess of 20,000, the political party had to disclose your identity. Who is the donor to this political party? But if you are donating money less than 20,000 to a political party, there is no need to disclose the identity of the donor. But why? The rationale, the reason given by the political parties were that we organize a rally. In this rally, thousands of people participate. At the end of the rally, we ask the members that you please donate funds, money to our political party, and they donate the money. We don't have the manpower to check each and every donation that is made to our political party, so we can't keep a track of these very small denomination donations that are given to our political parties. That is why there was a limit. So if you are donating money to a political party which is less than 20,000, there is no need for political party to disclose the identity of these donors. But if you are donating more than 20,000 to a political party, the political party is bound to disclose the identity of that donor. And you have to disclose it to Election Commission of India. You have to disclose it to tax authorities. But political parties are very sharp as well, very clever as well. They come up with a solution to this problem. They have a problem. But our political parties, they want to work in an opaque manner. They don't want transparency in our political donations. So what they do, when they submit these details to Election Commission and tax authorities, they say majority of our money came from less than 20,000 route. BSP party was asked 2 years ago, you have this much money in your bank account. Where did this money come from? Give us these details. BSP political party said 100% of our donations came from less than 20,000 route. That means no one donated money to us in excess of 20,000 rupees. Samajwadi party said 95% of our funds came from less than 20,000 route. Congress party said more than 85% of our funds came from less than 20,000 route. BJP said more than 67% of our funds came from less than 20,000 route. And then there was a cry in the society that this 20,000 limit is actually helping these political parties to maintain opacity in political donations. Then the finance minister, Mr. Arun Jaitley, came up with another innovative idea. He said, now we will change the law. If you are donating money to a political party about 2,000, then disclose the identity. If you donate money less than 2,000 to a political party, there is no need to disclose the identity of the donor. But even this reform is not going to help. Why? Let's say, for example, I am donating money 1 crore to a political party called A. Now, these political parties have treasurers. These political parties have chartered accountants. What they do? They divide this 1 crore rupees into receipts of 19,999. That means they divide this donation into receipts of 19,999 so that they don't have to disclose the identity of the donor. Now, the same thing will happen with this new change as well. If I am donating 1 crore rupee to a political party A, now their chartered accountants, what they will do? They will divide this 1 crore rupees into donations of 1999. And ultimately, the identity of the donor will not be known to the public. So basically, who is the biggest beneficiary in this changed law? The biggest beneficiary are these chartered accountants which are hired by political parties. Normally, they will ask for more money from political parties, better salary from political parties, because now their work has increased. Initially, they had to divide money into receipts of 19,999. Now they will have to do that into receipts of 1999. So the problem will still persist. Then the government came up with another innovative idea. They said that we will now have electoral bonds. What are these electoral bonds? If you want to donate money to a political party, what you have to do, you have to approach State Bank of India. Pay money to State Bank of India through either check or through digital transaction. Let's say, for example, I have to donate 10 crore rupees to a political party A. Now I approach State Bank of India. I pay this 10 crore rupees through check or through digital transaction, and State Bank of India will issue an electoral bond. And this electoral bond, I have to then deposit into the bank account of this political party A. Now, these electoral bonds are bearer bonds. How are they bearer bonds? That means when I am paying the State Bank of India through check or digital transaction, the bonds are issued by State Bank of India. The identity of mine, that means my identity, will not be known. That means nobody will come to know who bought this electoral bond. Second, when I'm donating money to this political party, when I'm depositing this electoral bond into the bank account of the party A, even this party A will not know who has deposited money into my bank account. So the entire system again is very opaque. But is this money clean? Yes. Why is it clean? Because the problem is with the cash donation. Cash is viewed as illicit money in this country. But if the money is paid through check or digital transaction, we can safely assume that this is white money, this is clean money, this is not illicit money. That means, yes, the money that is paid to the political parties is clean money, but there is no transparency in the system. And that is the biggest flaw in these electoral bonds. If I am the voter, I need to understand, if I am voting for a political party, which political party is supported by which corporate agency. For example, if I am an environmentalist, I believe in the protection of environment, I will not vote for a political party which is supported by those corporates who are wreaking havoc on our environment, who are destroying our environment. And I should know. That means there has to be this transparency in the system that who are the donors and funders of these political parties. But not just this, through this electoral bond, the biggest beneficiary is the government of the day. When we say that these are bearer bonds, that means the identity of the donor is unknown. Nobody will come to know who donated money to which political party. But if there is one entity which will know who is donating whom, it is the government. How? You approach, let's say for example, person X approaches State Bank of India and wants to purchase these electoral bonds. State Bank of India is under the control of the government. So government would know that who is buying these electoral bonds. Second, these electoral bonds are then to be deposited into the bank account of a political party. Now these bank accounts are controlled by Reserve Bank of India. And there are allegations that since Reserve Bank of India has lost its independence, it is under the control of the government. So the government would know who bought this bond and which political party's bank account was this electoral bond deposited in. So it is going to be beneficial only for the government of the day. Now let's say, for example, an individual Y wants to purchase this electoral bond and wants to deposit this electoral bond into the bank account of an opposition political party, then this individual Y can be pressurized by the government through various means and ultimately can be threatened not to donate money to the opposition political party. So these electoral bonds go against the principle of free and fair elections. And free and fair election is also part of the basic structure of Indian Constitution. And this newspaper article talks about that electoral bonds, which are the new innovation in our political funding, the Election Commission is yet to decide whether electoral bonds shall continue or not. They are yet to respond to these allegations that electoral bonds are against the concept of free and fair elections in this country. That is what you need to understand from this newspaper article. And beyond these three newspaper articles, one dealing with the Amritsar accident, the other with the organophosphate, the gel that has the potential to protect the lives of the agricultural farmers and workers, and these electoral bonds, there is nothing much in today's newspaper that is relevant for your exam, apart from the editorials. And now let's look at some of these editorials and columns from today's newspaper. Beginning with, keep the peace. Sabarimalai verdict was given by the Supreme Court, wherein Supreme Court said that this age-old practice where women in the age group of 10 to 50, menstruating women, they are not allowed entry into the sanctum sanctorum of the Sabarimalai temple. This is unconstitutional. And women of all ages were allowed entry into the temple. Now the season started in Sabarimalai. Two women, they tried to enter the Sabarimalai temple. One was a journalist, the other was an activist, but they were pelted with stones. Protests are going on in Kerala, and ultimately these protesters are saying that law of the land, which is the Supreme Court verdict, it will not apply in Sabarimala. What we need to understand, we need to look at this issue in a dispassionate manner. There are sensibilities involved. There are religious affections involved on this issue. If a devotee would not have been allowed entry into the Sabarimalai temple, then we could have asked that this practice is abhorrent, this practice should stop. But what is the point of two activists who are self-proclaimed atheists? And what is the point of these activists entering into the Sabarimalai temple? If they are atheists, if they are non-believers, if they are not the devotees of the Lord Ayyappa, what is their point in raking up this controversy and trying to enter the Sabarimalai temple? Why are they raising these passions and ultimately hurting the religious sensibilities of the devotees of the Lord Ayyappa? So this is something that we have to carefully look at. There was no point for these activists, no reason for these activists to make a trek and try to enter the Sabarimalai temple. But at the same time, we cannot resort to hooliganism. The manner in which the protesters in Kerala, both women as well as men, they search the vehicles for women and then they try to force these women not to enter the Sabarimalai temple. Force has no place in democracy. So this hooliganism must in all ways and in all manners be protested, but we at the same time cannot also turn a blind eye to the fact that there are some individuals who are trying to become celebrities, who are trying to gather the airtime on TV studios, these activists who are trying to vitiate the atmosphere by entering or trying to enter into a temple and then hurting the religious sensibilities of the devotees. So this editorial talks about that the immediate task is to dial down the tensions over Sabarimalai and we have to keep the peace. Now let us look at another important editorial from the IR perspective, the Taliban surge. Now we have discussed this before as well, that when 9/11 attacks took place, the United States tried to pressurize Afghanistan government, which was controlled by Taliban at that point in time, that you should hand over Osama bin Laden, who is the mastermind of these 9/11 attacks on the Twin Towers as well as on Pentagon. But the refusal by Afghan government to hand over Osama bin Laden to US authorities ultimately led to war on terror on Afghanistan. US bombed Afghanistan and then there was regime change. The Taliban were booted out and ultimately there was a civilian government in place in Afghanistan. But even this civilian government in Afghanistan, we have seen many elections after that. This civilian administration in Afghanistan has not been in a position to bring peace to Afghanistan. And we have seen that Taliban is now gaining the lost ground. It is now carrying attack after attack and vast swaths of land is now under the control of Taliban. Now the world community took notice of this. Russia on one hand, United States on the other hand, they are trying to hold talks with Taliban so as to bring Taliban on the peace table, on the negotiating table, so that there can be peace in Afghanistan. 2 days before the parliamentary election in Afghanistan, now Taliban has attacked the Kandahar. And there, one of the most prominent police officers, Mr. Razik, was assassinated. And many others were also killed in this dastardly attack. So this attack on a high-level meeting which took place inside the governor's house, inside the governor's office in Kandahar, top security officials were killed. It is yet another reminder of sharply deteriorating security situation in Afghanistan. That is what this editorial talks about. This editorial says that in recent years, the Taliban has shown the capacity that it has the potential to enter into the meeting area of government officials and blow this meeting ground and ultimately inflict maximum possible damage on the government side. And that is what is the cause of worry in Afghanistan right now. This Taliban attack is further blow to the Afghan election as well as this peace process which US Russia is trying to negotiate with Taliban so that there is peace in Afghanistan. That is what you need to understand from this newspaper editorial. Now let's look at statesmanship, not brickmanship, that is written by Sandeep Bhardwaj of Center for Policy and Research. The content of this newspaper column we have already discussed in day before yesterday's The Hindu newspaper analysis, wherein we talked about how the low voter turnout in the Kashmir local body election is a wake-up call for New Delhi and the political class. And this editorial, this column basically puts the onus on BJP to revisit the pages of Kashmir's political history and avoid an approach that can lead to short-term gains, but the long-term result would be disastrous for the state of Jammu and Kashmir and the project Kashmir for India. And this column also talks about what we discussed that day about the 1987 state elections, which are widely believed as the rigged elections in Jammu and Kashmir, which ultimately paved way for militancy in 1989. Now let's look at the Jamal Khashoggi affair. Now it has been confirmed by Saudi authorities that Jamal Khashoggi was indeed killed inside the Saudi Arabian consulate in Istanbul, Turkey. But they say it was because of the fist fight that occurred inside the consulate. But what we need to understand is the difference and the approach of Saudi administration vis-a-vis Jamal Khashoggi. It is very important to understand that Jamal Khashoggi was, after all, a one individual. He was at once very close to the power circles in Riyadh. He was the one who welcomed the Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman when he embarked on reformist agenda in Saudi Arabia, when he opened cinema halls, also allowed women drivers to drive without their male partners involved. But at the same time, he was also critical of the vendetta politics played by Mohammed bin Salman, and ultimately he paid an individual price for this. And he was liquidated, he was killed inside the consulate in Istanbul. But what we need to understand that Saudi Arabia justifies this. Saudi Arabia justifies this in the name of what is now called national interest. And this national interest has been used repeatedly by many governments in the world. For example, United States, which is under pressure right now from various quarters, that you should put pressure on your ally Saudi Arabia, that the perpetrators of this heinous crime wherein Jamal Khashoggi was killed, those perpetrators should be brought to book. He is pressurized by various quarters that $1 billion arms sale that is between United States and Saudi Arabia, United States should cancel the sale and weapons of this $1 billion deal to Saudi Arabia. Donald Trump is saying that we cannot cancel this deal because it is in the interest of United States. It is a national interest that we should proceed with this deal because, after all, it will give jobs to the citizens of United States. Similarly, Saudi Arabia is also justifying its activities in the name of national interest. But what about India? This article talks about that Saudi Arabia, as well as Iran, what they are trying to do, they have been, since even before independence, pumping money into India. Saudi is pumping money and is funding the Sunni groups in India. Iran is pumping money and funding the Shia groups in India, and they are radicalizing the Muslims in India. But India is neither protesting against the Saudi nor is India protesting against the Iran on this matter. After all, radicalizing the Muslims by Saudi and Iran, it is against the internal security of India. It is as if Saudi Arabia and Iran are meddling into the Indian or internal affairs of India. Yet India is not protesting. Why? Again, in national interest. Indian government feels that since we are dependent upon Saudi and Iran for oil and for other purposes, we should not overtly and covertly protest against the Saudi and Iranian influence in radicalizing the Muslims in India. But this column talks about that India has a potential and India has the ability to confront Saudi and Iran in the name of national interest. Because if you are not protesting against the Saudi Arabians primarily because you want oil from Saudi Arabia, you should not worry about this. Because more than you wanting oil from Saudi Arabia, it is the Saudi Arabia which wants to sell oil to India. Why? Because if they don't sell oil to India, they will lose out on money. And they would require this money for their misadventures in Yemen, where they are fighting a war in Yemen. They need this money for the $1 billion arms deal that they want to carry out with United States. So more than India requiring and needing oil from Saudi Arabia, it is the Saudi Arabia which wants to sell oil to India. And that is the card that India needs to play with Saudi Arabians, so that in the national interest, the radicalization of Indian Muslims should not continue by Iran as well as by Saudi Arabia. Now let us look at some of the prelims based questions and mains based questions. Match the following: Atal 1 and Atal 2. In today's newspaper, you will see that these two peaks have been scaled by the people, and Atal 1 and Atal 2, they are from Uttarakhand. Annamudai, Kerala, Dodapita Peak in Tamil Nadu, Guru Shikhar Peak in Rajasthan. So the correct option is A. Which of the following countries border the Indian Ocean? Let's look at the map. We have Mozambique, we have Tanzania, we have Kenya, we have Somalia. Ethiopia is not bordering the Indian Ocean. So what is the correct response? 1, 2, 4 and 5. Let's look at previous year's question paper. Acid rain is caused by the pollution of environment by nitrous oxide and sulfur dioxide. Now let's look at the mains based question. And there are many people who are writing to us on emails that although we take up current affairs based, mains based questions, but what about the static portion? How can we answer the static portion questions that are asked in our mains examination? So today I have picked one static question, and that question deals with your polity. List some suggestions to make the post of governor effective again. Let's see how to write the answer. The recommendations of the Sarkaria Commission and Punchi Commission report need to be examined closely to make proper amendments to the functions of the post of governor. So you have to write to the point and direct answer. You don't have to beat around the bush. You don't have to write about how the governors are appointed, how the governors are removed, who appoints the governor, because the examiner knows that you know all these details. The examiner only needs to examine whether you know how to write the precise answer to the question that has been asked. Governorship should go to eminent persons with impeccable credentials rather than these posts becoming dumping grounds for retired politicians. A national panel should be prepared after involving the opposition, ruling party, civil society in the selection process, and governor should be appointed from this panel after consultation with the chief minister of the state. Ideally speaking, a governor should not be posted in his native state because then he will be too involved with the politics of that state, nor should be and should preferably have been at a distance from the active politics of that state for a significant period. That means you should not have been involved in any capacity in that state's politics because then you will be too involved in the politics of that state. The arbitrary dismissals of the governor should be stopped at all costs by legislating for a fixed tenure. He should not enjoy office at the pleasure of the president, and his removal from office must entail impeachment proceedings in the parliament. The process of dismissal of governor should be made as difficult as the removal of the High Court judges. Because the governors hold office during the pleasure of the president. They can be appointed at any point in time. They can be removed at any point in time. Since their tenure depends upon the whims and the fancies of the central government, in all likelihood, they take and they toe the line of the central government. That is why to insulate the office of governor from the politics of the central government, we should have a fixed tenure and an impeachment way of removal of the governor. The governor should not be allowed to acquire political positions for a certain period after relinquishing his post. That means there has to be some cooling off period. This will enhance the independence of his office and give him more teeth in functioning. The discretionary power need to be withheld. There has to be a clear-cut guideline on the appointment of CM, for example, inviting the leader of the largest pre-poll alliance or party to form the government. For example, we saw in Goa, the leader of the second largest party was invited to form the government. In Karnataka, the leader of the largest party was asked to form the government. So there is no clear-cut rule. There is no clear-cut formula that the governor has to follow while appointing the chief minister when there is no clear-cut majority for any political party. And here the discretionary power of the governor becomes even more strong. It is within the discretionary power of the governor to decide who can be the next chief minister of that state. Since this power has the potential to be misused, abused, overused, we need to have a clear-cut guideline of who can be the chief minister of a state. As far as power to reserve bills is concerned, because any bill can be reserved by the governor for the consideration of the president, including a money bill. For that, this power should continue, but it should be resorted in the rarest of the rare cases and not on liberal interpretation or malicious intent. If needed, the governors should be made legally binding to enlist the opinion of the High Court of that state before the bills are reserved for the consideration of the president. This is how the answer to this question can be written for your mains examination. That is it for now. Thank you for being with us. Have a great day.